Press the bell icon on YouTube and don't miss another update.
I have with me young scholar, historian, columnist Vikram Sampath. Vikram has recently written a book on one of the most controversial thinkers of our times, a biography on Veer Savarkar. I have with me Vikram to talk a little bit more about the book, about the construction of history in our times and the politicization of history in our times. Vikram, welcome to ThePrint. Vikram, first up, why Savarkar, why now, and when did you really begin studying him?
If not now, when else will Savarkar be relevant, considering, you know, there's so much about Savarkar that intrudes modern political discourse. You know, every election campaign, his name is invoked. There's Rahul Gandhi mocking him in some campaign, and then there's Savarkar's descendants or somebody who are filing defamation cases against him. Prime Minister Modi goes to cellular jail and actually pays his obeisances there. You have the Rajasthan government, you know, removing the Veer from his name in school textbooks. So a person who died in 1966, and in 2019, his name is still invoked and he becomes so relevant to people. And I observed, you know, as a student myself, I'd never really read about Savarkar in our history textbooks in school. And my first brush with him, unfortunately, happened in 2003, 2004, when first the Vajpayee government, you know, installed a plaque in his memory in Port Blair. And then you had the whole incident of Manishankar Iyer trying to get that out of the place. And that's when I think the debate around Savarkar started getting so vicious and also polarized. My interest was piqued in him then, because any character which is vilified or, you know, misunderstood, it somehow kind of interests me a lot. And
how has Savarkar been vilified and misunderstood?
I think a lot of the narrative that was set, especially after 2003-2004, has been around this construct of the mercy petitions, or the petitions that he signed to secure his release from the cellular jail in Port Blair. And that has been used by a lot of leftist historians as a stick to beat him with. And then there are you know, allegations of his being working in cohorts with the British, his ideology of Hindutva, which is in the political ascendant today in India. He was the one who gave it structure and shape and form in 1923.
Right. You said leftist historians are somehow responsible in vilifying him?
Yes, so, I guess so.
Do you identify yourself as a right-wing historian then?
No, I think for the longest time, I think history in this country has been captive to these competing viewpoints. And somewhere, despite the talk about, you know, liberal views and freedom of expression, when it comes to history, because he who controls the past controls the present and the future, as Orwell had said. So history has been used as a tool, particularly by those in power. And ever since the ICHR came up in the 1970s, to stifle any kind of competing viewpoint. Now, there's nothing absolutist, you know, in history. There are competing views, there are alternative narratives. But then the alternative narrative when it comes to history is never given a chance, has never been given a chance so far. So I would place myself as somebody, a young man in India who would like to, who's trained in history, who also would like to look at history objectively on the basis of, you know, the facts that stare you in the face.
You know, you mentioned the importance of nuances in history, but we know for a fact that now more than perhaps ever, history is being hotly contested. There are statues and there is an attempt to sort of vilify some people and sort of worship the others. Do you think the space for nuance in history is in fact shrinking, or do you think the hold of, as you said, the liberal secular historians is being broken, and what we are seeing is a ramification of that?
I think it's the latter, because for the longest time, any alternative viewpoint has never been, you know, accepted or allowed to grow. Those who held alternative viewpoints, their careers have been destroyed, especially in history. This very cozy ecosystem that was created around, you know, you scratch my back, I scratch your back, and we all belong to the same ideological cohort. So that is finally being challenged today. And so naturally, there's a lot of churn, I think, in the discipline.
What do you think is spurring this change? Do you think it's the political environment in the country that's spurring this change? What is it that has allowed, as you said, the alternative voice to grow in history?
I guess for the first time, after 2014 and with the coming of Mr. Modi, we're seeing a paradigm shift in almost every field, whether it's the media, whether it's the arts, whether it's academics, every field, cultural institutions. For the longest time, these have been the fiefdom of a few people sitting largely in what is infamously called Lutyens' Delhi and so on, who have been scripting the narrative for the whole of India. And I think Mr. Modi himself being an outsider to Delhi and the politics here, and him having come and captured power in this way and having gotten re-elected, you know, with this kind of a mandate, suddenly brings to the fore a lot of people whose voices were not heard. They do think that this is a time when, you know, these voices can also be heard.
Do you think there's a new Lutyens' Delhi that's being created, or do you think there are many Lutyens within Delhi that are being created now?
It's such a infamous word, but I think it's a competition for space which is happening, which is a good thing.
It's a competition to be
the Lutyens. Yeah, but I don't think the new one has really taken over, because I think the priorities were different in terms of setting so many things in order.
Vikram, coming back to Veer Savarkar, he's obviously a bundle of contradictions, right? He's someone who identified himself as a rationalist. He was an atheist. He was a beef-eating atheist.
I don't think he ate beef himself.
But he was okay with people sort of eating.
It's a different issue. It's a nuance which goes out. He talks about cow worship and cow protection, and says, when it comes to, and that is relevant today in when all these lynchings and all of this is happening, where he says, elevating a cow to the status of a goddess probably is an insult to both divinity and humanity, where, you know, you already have 33 crore devis and devtas. There's no need to elevate an animal.
Right. But, since you mentioned that Savarkar was probably not comfortable with elevating the cow to this pedestal and worshipping it in this manner, do you think he would have been disillusioned by the way Hindutva and cow politics is playing out today, in the way of lynchings, in the way of targeting the Muslim community? Do you think he would have been upset over that?
Certainly, because even in his writings, he says when it comes to an animal and a human being, and if the animal's interest supersedes that of the human being, that should be discarded.
Since we're short on time, I'll come back to Veer Savarkar.
Yes.
I was asking you, since he's, he was an atheist, he was someone who identified himself as a rationalist, yet he was very fixed on the Hindu identity. What one wonders really is, how was he different from, say, a Jinnah, who was an atheist himself, who was a scotch-drinking Muslim, but wanted a Muslim nation? So he was very, in a way, fixed on the Muslim identity, yet in his personal life was distanced from it.
Right.
So, how was Veer Savarkar different from Jinnah?
Savarkar defined it completely different from religion. It was a cultural and a national identity, where he said anybody who considers this piece of land from the Indus to the seas as his or her Pitrubhu, or the land of their forefathers, or their Punyabhu, the holy land, and not some other land across the seas, only then you can guarantee the territorial integrity, the loyalty and all of that to your country, and not owe your extra national kind of an allegiance. They are all Hindus. And he actually asks questions in the treatise himself, saying, what about people like Annie Besant or Sister Nivedita, who were not Indian born, they were Christians, but then he says they were probably as much or more dedicated to this country and consider it as her holy land, and so they would be called Hindus. And so this confusion becomes because it's the same word as a religion, but for him it was giving the country a sense of identity. So in that way, if you see all his statements, it's about one God, one country, one race. He called for a complete disemberment of the caste system, removal of untouchability. Everybody is one community. So unlike Jinnah's separatist kind of a view, which looked at a separate identity itself, this was actually all embracing and inclusive, in my view. And Savarkar, given his role in all of this, naturally becomes the bone of contention, and more so since he is associated with the ruling party now and the the BJP and everyone who vilifies it thinks that the best way to get to the BJP is by getting to Savarkar.
Right. Vikram, even though he does still remain a hotly contested figure, I think the fact that you've written this biography does sort of symbolize a shift in history that is taking place. Thank you so much for joining us at The Print. It was lovely talking to you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Sanya. Thank you.